This episode is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform to build a beautiful online presence, like me.
Radical acceptance is as much about accepting the things you cannot change.
Must I do?
As recognizing, do I need to step up? Because that's what morality requires.
Hobbits really are amazing creatures.
And because, since I can't escape this fate, what's the most amount of good I can do with the cards I've been dealt?
I will take the ring to Mordor.
Though, I do not know the way.
These films are a stunning feat of filmmaking. It is mind-blowing. They're still possibly the best films ever made, as far as just filmmaking craft.
Glad to be with you, Samwise Gamgee.
And I love when Frodo pivots emotionally from his own elation to being there for his friend.
Here at the end of all things.
And that is a very honorable thing to do. Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist, and I love movies. This is
Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker. I need therapy. Are you gonna give me some?
No. We're friends, and I don't want to.
That would be a
hard rejection after hard rejection.
I was gonna say that would be a dual relationship, which is bad. But doesn't want to.
That's the
which
real
is
reason.
Good.
So today we're going to be doing a Psychology of a Hero episode on Frodo Baggins.
My second favorite hero.
Yes.
Oh, Mr. Baggins.
Frodo of the Shire. And we're going to be talking about the psychology of honor.
Okay, interesting.
If you look at honor, it's three things. It's doing what's right,
sure.
It's following through,
yep.
And then it's the esteem and praise and adulation, you know, to be held in high honor.
Right.
And by all three definitions, Frodo meets the criteria.
Very honorable hobbit.
So why should we care, and what does this have to do with psychology?
That is a question I had.
Well, Dr. Pochi Wu, in his Psychology Today article, What Has Happened to the Concept of Honor, asked the question if honor still has a place in society or if it's an old-fashioned notion.
Okay.
What say you?
Yes, honor does have a place in society, Jonathan.
And back to you, Jonathan. Okay.
Okay. No, look, honor is super important. I think the idea is honor gets de-emphasized because we have so many shows about anti-heroes and this and that and the other.
Yeah.
But we also have tons of media that is about the honorable character, like the most popular series that
mm-hmm.
there are. Star Wars, Luke Skywalker, super honorable.
Yeah.
Lord of the Rings, freaking everybody.
Captain America and Harry Potter, like all these characters, the hero has honor and integrity. The side characters may have less, and we may find them more interesting.
Sure.
But at the end of the day, we aspire to be like Frodo. The reason I would say psychologically honor matters is for our mental and emotional health. The cognitive dissonance when you have a value and you don't hold to it can be excruciating.
Oh, it can be damaging.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then when it comes to relationships, without honor, there's no trust. And without trust, there's no healthy relationships. Mm-hmm. And then on a societal level, we see the rotten corruption that we currently see all around us today. So let's aspire to something greater.
The world's great. Just not.
There's nothing any of us can do. We're all screwed.
Not on a macro level. On a micro level, the world actually is pretty great.
It's okay.
On a macro level. So number one, honor is radical acceptance.
Frodo. He must never find it.
All right. We put it away. We keep it hidden. We never speak of it again. No one knows it's here, do they?
So Frodo's trying to get rid of it, trying to pretend that this isn't going on.
Still hard to believe that that's a visual effect shot. I literally can't pick the lines.
There is one other who knew that Bilbo had the ring. I looked everywhere for the creature Gollum. But the enemy found him first.
I was going to say, Shire
Baggins! Amidst the endless screams and inane babble.
But, so radical acceptance is the concept of, I spend my energy on the things I can control, not the things I can't.
Right.
And Frodo right now, there's something that he doesn't want to deal with.
That would lead them here.
Which, who would want to deal with that?
I don't want to deal with that. This guy is going to try to deal with it.
Take it, Gandalf. Take it.
No, Frodo.
You must take it.
You cannot offer me this ring.
I'm giving it to you.
Don't! Tempt me, Frodo! I dare not take it. Not even to keep it safe. Understand, Frodo. I will use this ring from a desire to do good. But through me, it would wield a power too great and terrible to imagine.
So Frodo's first.
But it cannot stay in the Shire.
No. No, it can't.
So first he's like, let's hide it. Then he's like, here, you take it.
Yeah, he's trying to get rid of it any way he can. He doesn't want the responsibility.
Yeah. But I love that last shot. His fingers close on the ring and he says, what must I do?
Yeah.
And that, folks, is radical acceptance. Frodo's trying to change his situation here. Let's just pretend the problem doesn't exist. We never speak of it. We just...
Nobody knows it's here, do they, Gandalf?
Right. And we do this with our problems. I mean, that's human nature. We don't want to face up to things. And then if we can, we'd prefer to hand it off to somebody else. And radical acceptance is as much about accepting the things you cannot change as recognizing, okay, at what point do I need to step up? Because that's what morality requires. And because since I can't escape this fate, what's the most amount of good I can do?
Right.
With the cards I've been dealt, right? Mm-hmm. It could be a cancer diagnosis. It could be, you know, a child who's struggling with different problems. It could be any number.
It could be a breakup.
It could be a breakup. It could be any number of things that are outside of our control. So the question then becomes, all right, since I can't change this fate, what can I do to be the best version of me and to do the most amount of good? And that's one of the things I love most about Frodo.
Have you seen our new cinema therapy website? We just launched it this summer, and it's great. And it was so easy to build and customize our site using Squarespace. Squarespace has a ton of templates to choose from with a wide variety of styles and formats. But one does not simply use the template for their website. Fortunately, once we found a template that was a great starting point, we were able to go in and change our branding, fonts, colors, add personal touches, and really customize the site to our needs. And Fluid Engine, the design system from Squarespace, makes it so easy to customize their templates. All we have to decide is what to do with the template given to us. They have built-in tools like video blocks and extensions for lots of platforms, so our website can be a hub to link to everything that we do. YouTube, Patreon, our merch and popcorn stores, even our upcoming events like the Council of Allen and Jono's 11-1st birthday party. They're customizable templates, transferable websites, pre-built layouts, and the Squarespace Help Center made it super easy and simple for us to get our website up and running. So one does simply use Squarespace to build an awesome website. Check out squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/cinematherapy to get 10% off of your first website or domain. Squarespace. Defending the realm of Middle-earth since 3018 Third Age. I have no idea how old Squarespace is.
Number two, honor is stepping up to do what must be done.
No one trusts them out!
The sound design in this scene is so great, how everything fades down and gets echoey and distant. And he just starts hearing the black speech.
Mm-hmm. But then instead of being afraid and running from it, that's the best shot right there. The best
acting. That close up on Gandalf's face.
As he, yeah.
It's so good.
I will take the ring to Mordor.
And when you talk about half of acting is the reacting, and half of directing is like...
I do not know the way.
To show the faces of everybody when he says it, the amount of awe.
You know, the recognition from Aragorn, like all he does is like raise his chin and change the set of his eyes. And just from that, you get, he knows how strong these little hobbits are.
Yeah.
He, you know, doesn't know things are going to be okay, but he knows that this is the best option.
Yeah.
And then you get Gimli just going like, well, he's not a dwarf, you know? Like,
I have the eyes of a hawk and the ears of a fox.
Ooh. At least he's small. Yeah.
When I was watching the scene for the first time, and all the audio goes down on everybody else, and you hear the black speech, and you see the fire rushing through, if I were in Frodo's shoes, I'd be like, yeah, I'm out.
Yeah.
Like, all of these great, noble warriors... Look at how quickly this thing just corrupted all of them in an instant, and now they're all fighting and bickering.
Mm-hmm.
And I can see exactly what's going on. I can feel the evil influence, and Frodo says, I will take it.
Yeah.
This is why when people are like, listen, I'm not disparaging Samwise Gamgee. Samwise is arguably the hero of the trilogy. But when people, in order to build up Sam, tear down Frodo and say Frodo's not the real hero, it's like, Frodo did what nobody else could do.
Yeah.
You know, and this moment is such a heroic moment. So you talked about earlier, you still can't believe that earlier shot of Frodo and Gandalf is a visual effects shot.
Yeah.
Watching this trilogy, the amount of mental gymnastics it would take, because I know sometimes it's...
Sometimes they're doing forced perspective shots. Yeah. Sometimes they're comping things. So they're shooting two different plates and compositing them together. It is mind-blowing to me. Having watched them maybe 24 times in the last 20 years, they're still possibly the best films ever made as far as just filmmaking craft. It is mind-blowing, and the quantity of it.
Yeah. Number 3, honor is using your time to make a difference.
I think I know what scene we're going to watch. This scene is just so beautifully lit.
Mm-hmm.
I wish the ring had never come to me. I wish none of this had happened.
So do all who live to see such times, but that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given to us. There are other forces at work in this world, Frodo, besides the will of evil. Bilbo was meant to find the ring. In which case, you also were meant to have it. And that is an encouraging thought.
So something that echoes through the story of Bilbo and Frodo is they both rather just be at home.
They're hobbits. They want to, you know, have breakfast and elevensies.
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
second breakfast.
It reminds me of the scene in the Hobbit trilogy, one of the better scenes, where Bilbo is telling the dwarves.
Look, I know you doubt me. I know you always have. And you're right. I often think of Bag End. I miss my books. And my armchair, my garden. See, that's where I belong. That's home.
That he loves his home and his garden and his books and his chair, and he misses all that. Mm. But that makes him an asset, not a liability. He says, your home was taken from you, and I will help you get it back. Right? Yeah. That he understands how important home is. And I see a similar thing with Frodo. Frodo would much rather be mucking about the Shire, goofing around with his friends,
mm-hmm.
you know, doing silly dances in the Green Dragon. But instead he's here, and as Gandalf astutely reminds him, and this is part of radical acceptance, you're here, so what are you going to do about it? And this really solidifies for Frodo, I'm going to use whatever I have to make a difference.
Yeah.
And then also the pity component, which is going to feed into our next clip. Frodo learns that from Gandalf. And that takes us to number 4, which is honor is doing right by others and giving them a chance.
Hmm.
Why are you? It's hopeless. Every orc in Mordor's going to hear this racket.
If that's not walking with a kid anywhere.
That would kill us. Kill us.
One of my favorite uses of surround sound ever in a movie is actually in this scene. It's like the big wide leading into this. And his shriek is all in the back channels. And it just, it just gets inside your brain.
Now that I see him, I do pity him.
We swears to do what he wants. We swears.
There's no promise you can make that I can trust.
We swears to serve the master of the precious. We will swear on the precious.
The ring is treacherous. It will hold you to your word.
Yes. I'm not precious.
Like Bilbo, Frodo shall wed.
I love Gollum so much.
Give it to us. Roar and wriggling.
And that's the thing is, there are scenes where you're supposed to feel sorry for him, and you do, but you still can't help but be amused at the thought of Andy Serkis in a mocap suit, just really going for it.
And then the performance, you know, that the animators put into mm-hmm. the character of Gollum. It's one of the all-time great film performances, and it's an animated character. I mean, they had, you know, obviously mocap reference for physical movement and stuff, and they had his voice, but that's not what Andy Serkis's face looks like. They had to do a lot of animation, and it's so good.
For the most part, they are his mannerisms, like you're saying. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's incredible. So Frodo, here he's doing the honorable thing. And you have to balance honor with being savvy, being smart, being wary, right? Because doing right by others and giving them a chance doesn't mean letting your guard down or just giving someone your trust when it hasn't been earned.
Right. If you just by default trust people, you're just going to get taken advantage of. And that's not honoring anyone.
Right. And so I think life experience can show you, okay, here's how much I'm comfortable giving. Here's the amount of risk I'm willing to put into the situation. And for some people, it's going to be very small.
Yeah.
Right. But I can still do right by them.
Well, and it's so beautifully illustrated in this scene. You can see, you know, we look at Gollum, and when we cut back to Frodo and Sam, Sam is looking at Gollum with disgust. Frodo is looking at him with a mixture of, what can I do to trust this guy?
Yeah.
Because I know I can't abuse him.
Yeah.
And it's such an interesting dynamic to see. And both of the actors, Sean Astin and Elijah Wood, are just playing those emotions so well. And it's just such a good scene, like most of the scenes in these movies.
Speaking of Frodo and Sam, Frodo shows honor by sharing credit.
I wonder if we'll ever be put into songs or tales.
What?
I wonder if people will ever say, let's hear about Frodo in the ring. And they'll say, yes, it's one of my favorite stories. Frodo was really courageous, wasn't he, Dad?
Yes, my boy. The most famousest of hobbits. And that's saying a lot.
You've left out one of the chief characters.
Samwise the Brave.
Are we just going to quote this whole
scene?
I'm
all about Sam. We could do it.
Here I go.
Okay.
Frodo wouldn't have gone far without Sam.
Don't go making fun, Mr. Frodo.
You shouldn't make fun. I was being serious.
So was I, Sam.
So was I. Samwise the Brave.
Okay, let me do that again.
Frodo wouldn't have made it far without Sam.
So, shares credit. Shares credit and glory.
We're so dumb. Welcome to us just loving on this movie.
Shares credit and glory. People don't share credit and glory out of a place of insecurity.
Yeah.
And then mask it and project this great confidence and this look at me and this pompousness and look at what I've accomplished. And Frodo doesn't have any of that, which to me says that humility is honor.
Sure. That makes sense.
Of course, this journey is a hard one. Mm-hmm. It's a long one. That's what she said. Damn it. I'm sorry. As the journey gets more and more difficult, we mm-hmm. see that honor is finding the inner strength to see things through.
Okay, this objectively shouldn't work. Like, why is he having this vision? What is going on?
So why does it work? Jesus? Close enough.
This task.
Galadriel might be better than Jesus.
No, whoa.
If you do not find a way, no one will.
Yeah, but knowing Tolkien's background, she's partially based.
Yeah. There's allusions all over the place. She is, Aragorn is, there's all kinds of stuff. But, no.
Gandalf dies and comes back all, like...
Yeah, comes back as Gandalf the White.
Yeah, all, like, bright and shiny, right?
Glowy.
So why does the scene work?
It works so well because I have no idea why. I honestly don't know why.
But it does.
It does. But think about it. Let's pitch this scene.
Okay.
We're pitching it
okay.
to a production executive, right? So, okay, Frodo has just come through Shelob's lair. He barely defeated this giant spider and got away. And then he's like struggling into Mordor. It's his darkest hour. And he collapses on the ground in this rocky desert and lands face first on soft moss. And then Galadriel shows up glowing and talks to him without opening her mouth. And then picks him up and we cut back to him being lifted by nothing.
You know how this scene works for me? This scene works for me. Actually, it works better if it's literal instead of metaphorical. Not that he's literally in the woods, but you see earlier that she can communicate with just her thoughts to Frodo. And I see her, wherever she is, reaching out to him with that power.
She is reaching out psychically. She's using the powers of Nenya, her ring of power.
Oh.
I'm a huge dork.
Nerd!
That's not something from the books.
Yeah.
Even the psychic connections that they're able to do in the movies are not strictly speaking from the books, but there's stuff like that in the rest of Tolkien's legendarium. There's stuff like that.
To me personally, it's kind of cheesy if Frodo is hallucinating or daydreaming it, but it's super powerful if she's literally...
If it's literally happening.
Like...
It also, I mean, Howard Shore... Make things good.
This is very true. But she says, this task was assigned to you, and if you don't find a way to do it, no one will. That goes back to radical acceptance. Like, he has to find a way to get it done. And I don't know. I'm how often in your life as a husband or a father or a business owner or otherwise have you done things that you didn't think you were capable of doing because you literally had to?
Oh, constantly.
Yeah.
This is... Like half of my adult life is like, well, that's literally impossible. 2 weeks later, well, I did that, I guess.
Yeah. Number 7, honor is mourning with and comforting others.
Over now.
Imagine that would be a relief.
I can see the shadow.
And before he couldn't.
Around the Ohan River. Bagging.
I love that for his remembering, we push in on Sam.
The light.
Yeah, let's talk about that after the clip. I want to hear your thoughts on that.
Rosy cop dancing. She had ribbons in her hair. If ever I was to marry someone, it would have been her. It would have been her.
Directors think about. And you're still crying even as you're watching.
Of course I'm crying.
the multiple
I contain
levels.
Legions. I can both emotionally invest in a scene and go, I wonder how the hell they did that.
I think that's what makes you good at what you do.
There we go.
So why do you think the focus is on Sam while Frodo is talking about the Shire?
Two reasons. The direction is Frodo is laying back, eyes closed. He's not performing a lot with his eyes closed, picturing, you know, the Shire, which makes sense for what the character is doing. You're not getting inside very much because the eyes are the window on the soul.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is acting is reacting, right?
Yeah.
Direction is reaction.
Yeah.
Sam is reacting to what Frodo is saying. And we can see him as we push in slowly on Sam. We build up to where we get the emotional release of him saying, Rosie Cotton dancing.
Yeah.
Which is...
Well, and you see...
Well done, John Astin.
You see Frodo, and he's... The ring's gone, and he can finally remember home and remember good things, and it's a peaceful moment for him. And I, as an audience member, I see them looking at Sam as Sam's not having the same emotional experience Frodo is. Sam knows he's going to die on this rock with Frodo. And he's in a place of
mourning. And Frodo is so elated to just have the weight gone that he's not mourning yet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I love when Sam says that Frodo pivots emotionally from his own elation to being there for his friend.
Yeah.
And it's such a beautiful moment of selflessness. And that is a very honorable thing to do. And then, of course, the eagles come. Whee! And we get to number 8. Mm-hmm. Honor is accepting praise with humility.
I think I know what scene we're going to watch. I was right.
I'm doing this to break you.
It's going to work.
My friends. You bow to no one.
Yes, we already showed the scene in our Aragorn video, but we will show it in every video.
We will
show
this scene in unrelated videos.
Yeah.
It is about freaking Pixar movies.
Just throw it in there.
F you. It's the best scene ever in a movie. Come on.
What I love about this scene is the implication is, you know, a lot of people, honestly, like a lot of people online, I see them saying that, well, Frodo decided not to throw the ring in. And the only reason it went in is because Gollum attacked him and bit his finger off and all this, that, and the other. Mm-hmm. And the implication is that one mistake doesn't undo your honor.
Right.
A moment of weakness, a moment of humanity doesn't undo who you are and who you've been this whole time. And I think that's such a powerful message because we can get hung up on, well, Sam didn't do anything wrong ever. And it's like, well, okay, but Sam wasn't...
He had very few opportunities.
Like... And that's not true because he was a... to Gollum, and that caused some serious problems.
Yeah.
Because the fact is, if Sam and Frodo had been compassionate to Smeagol, Gollum may never have come back.
It's true.
You know what I mean? So Sam's not perfect. He's amazing, but let's dial it down a little bit.
Who wants perfection?
Yeah.
Ugh,
there's
boring.
There's no heroism
there's
with
no
that.
No story there.
But Frodo's there. He's got an entire kingdom and the king and queen bowing before him, and he just looks completely humbled by it.
Right? Yeah.
He has acted with honor, and now he is receiving honor. And the beautiful thing moving forward, when he goes off with the elves and realizes that he can't be in the Shire anymore, there's no peace for him there, he's got too much trauma, is that after honoring Middle-earth and honoring his friends and doing right by everybody else, he's finally going to honor himself.
Yes.
And, you know, when it first came out and I was younger and immature, I always thought that scene was kind of cheesy, like at the end. And it's not. Like, I watch it now, and it's freaking beautiful because Frodo is honoring himself, and he's asking his friends to honor that. And they do. And this is the psychology of honor. Hope you enjoyed it.
Frodo is great. Who is that?
What are you doing?
Figwit.
Frodo, don't wear the ring. I know it's very tempting.
Oh my gosh.
True Lord of the Rings stands know what I'm talking about.
Woo!
Yeah, baby.
For Frodo.